What I will do in the next 15 minutes is give some background explanation about all the different options that are available for sequencing, and also some advantages and disadvantages of the different approaches. I will start off with a case to illustrate how genetic diagnostics can be done. It's a boy, 5 years old, and he presented with failure to thrive, protracted diarrhea, and he was in the ICU for a PCP infection. He had a brother, the brother of mother died at young age. When phenotyping was done for this boy, it was identified that no T cells were present, and that only B cells were present, and that also NK cells were also absent. Now, for this case, finding a genetic defect is not so complicated because there are several points leading to an X-linked disease. It's a boy, T cells are absent, so it's a SCID, and the gene linked to X-linked SCID is the IL-2 receptor gamma. And indeed, in this patient, a mutation was identified. And if the presentation is so clear, with a clear phenotype, a book type of clinical presentation, then Sanger sequencing is really rapid, and within 1 or 2 days you have the result. But this is sequencing. During the last years, last 20, 30 years, there has been enormous development in sequencing technology. In the early 90s, or before the 90s, there was sequencing according to Sanger, with radioactive Sanger sequencing. Then some years later, so at the end of the 90s, between 2000, you had also Sanger sequencing, but that was based on gel-based and fluorescent Sanger sequencing. So that was much easier because you could analyze many more samples in the same time. But the great advantage came that it was capillary sequencing, so you can analyze more samples at a time in a shorter time period. But next generation sequencing, that really gave a boost in the sequencing analysis, because in a much shorter time, many more genes patients could be analyzed. So the hands-on time of sequencing has gone down rapidly, and the amount of information you get from one experiment has increased tremendously. So especially with the introduction of next generation sequencing, but also before, a lot of patients could be identified with a genetic defect in the so-called PID candidate genes. And the increase really came with the next generation sequencing. And every 2 years, there's an update by the IOIS with all the PID genes. The last report was in 2014. And in the previous version, that was from 2011, 30 new genes were identified. And between the 2011 and the previous version, 15 new genes were identified, and now already more genes are identified for next versions. So the amount of PID candidate genes is really increasing, and increased a lot. It's important to realize that for one PID, there's not only one candidate gene. There can be one clinical presentation that can be caused by genetic defects in multiple different genes. So that's also complicating the diagnostics, because if you have a clear clinical phenotype, there can be more genetic defects in different genes. So that's important to know when you do genetics. It's also important to know that there's clinical heterogeneity, because if there's one PID gene mutated, it can give rise to a spectrum of different clinical phenotypes. And as also shown by Bobby Gasper yesterday, the RAC gene is really known to give a broad spectrum of diseases. It ranges from SCID, severe combined immunodeficiency, to OMEN, leaky SCID, CID, and even CD4 cytopenia can be caused by mutations in the RAC gene. The Li et al. Has shown in a large study that there's a phenotype-genotype correlation. So if there's a mutation in the RAC gene, it can be a full null mutation, so without residual activity, and then you can get a SCID. But if you have some residual activity because the mutation do not disrupt the complete function of the protein, there's some residual activity, and therefore you have a different clinical phenotype that can be milder. So also, depending on the type of mutation, you can have a certain clinical phenotype. But even that is not a complete story, because in our group we have shown in a series of 22 patients with the same mutation, you can also have all the different variants of SCID. So that means that it's not only mutation, but probably also other processes or other modifying genes who influence the clinical picture. So this is to illustrate that doing PID diagnosis is not really easy, that you have multiple genes, multiple presentations, that makes it complicated. At this moment, we have different options for genetic testings, and I would like to discuss different options that are available, and I will also make some considerations, because every technique or approach has advantages and disadvantages. I will start with Sanger sequencing of single PID candidate genes. So Sanger sequencing, that was the example I gave in the case. So then you sequence only one gene. The advantage is it's rapid, it's straightforward, the interpretation is straightforward, and with this approach you're sure that you sequence everything because you evaluate every nucleotide. So you're sure after analysis you sequenced all exons and the splice sites. The disadvantage of this approach is you can only analyze one gene. You can also analyze two genes, but you're really limited in the number of genes you can analyze. And you do not sequence the intron, so the part of DNA between the exons, and also the promoters are not covered. When you use next-generation sequencing for diagnostics, there's one approach called targeted sequencing or target enrichment sequencing. What you do, you select a set of genes and you analyze all these genes together. For example, you can analyze all known genes for SCID or all known genes for antibody deficiencies or for all PID genes or for all known PID genes and genes you think they might be mutated. And then the advantage is that you can sequence at one time all the genes. And the difference of the Sanger sequences is that the technology is different, and then it allows you to sequence a lot of more genetic information at a time. This is especially relevant in case of a complicated clinical presentation, because then you're not sure which candidate gene to choose, then you have a lot of genes to sequence, so this is a good approach for that. And it's also interesting to use this approach if you're sure it's a patient with an immunodeficiency. You identify also new phenotypes, because sometimes you find a genetic defect in a known candidate gene, but the patient presents differently. So you also identify new phenotypes in known PID genes. And it's also an advantage that you only can identify mutations in PID candidate genes, so these genes have already been described to be PID genes because mutations have already been described in other patients. The disadvantage of this approach is because of the technical method, you are not sure that you sequence every exon and every splice site, because you do not have full coverage. So you need to check whether you sequence the entire gene, and sometimes it's necessary to perform some Sanger sequencing of missing exons to be sure that you have sequenced all genes. It's more time consuming, most of the time the turnaround time is somewhat higher, and the reason for that is that you need to combine many patients in one run. So that's also depending on the center you are working, how many patients do you see, do you analyze, do you run a week, every week a run, or every 2 months. It's also depending on the amount of samples and the genes you analyze in your panel. The disadvantage is if there are new PID genes, you also need to adapt your test to redesign also to include this gene. And also it's a disadvantage that you only identify mutations in known PID genes and not in unknown. And it's known that the interpretation is more difficult because you're sequencing more genes, so you identify more variants, and you need to be sure that to pick out the real disease-causing mutation. So that's a fact for true for all sequencing analysis. If you find a variation, it doesn't mean that you find the disease-causing variant. You really need to make sure that the variation you find is affecting the protein, is not a polymorphism, and really affect the process. Then a lot of about whole exome sequencing and whole genome sequencing. This is a schematic slide to introduce the difference of it. This is a DNA strand, and this is the gene a bit enlarged. You have exons and you have introns. And with whole exome sequencing, you're sequencing only the coding regions. And with whole genome sequencing, you sequence the whole genome. That's what the name says. So also the non-coding regions. And it's important to realize that only 1% of the genome is taken by the exome. So you can imagine if you do whole genome sequencing, the amount of data you get is much larger. This is the principle of whole exome sequencing. You start with genomic DNA and you make it into fragments, and then you have hybridized it with kind of probes to select, in this case, for all the coding regions. And these are pulled down, and so you capture the DNA of the exome, and this is sequenced in a DNA sequencer. And that's in contrast to Sanger sequencing, in which you use primers to amplify all the different parts of the exons directly by PCR. So the advantage of whole exome sequencing is that you can identify all variations in all pidgin, because all the pidgins are part of the exome. And you can also identify new PID genes, because you sequence all genes. So this is really the advantage, that you can sequence all genes. At the same time, it's also a disadvantage, because if you analyze all genes, you can potentially also identify variants that you have predisposition to breast cancer or to other diseases. So this is also, it can be a disadvantage, and James Taylor will also go in more detail on that. It's also important to keep in mind that you never have 100% coverage. So if you do not find a disease-causing mutation in with whole exome sequencing, it can be that there is a mutation in a region that you do not cover, or it can also be in the introns that you do not sequence. So it's important to realize that interpretation of the whole exome sequence data is also complicated, because you find a lot of variants, and therefore a good bioinformatics support is absolutely needed. First of all, to analyze your data, to align it to your reference, to filter out this single nucleotide polymorphisms, and there are a lot of bioinformatic tools that to help you to find the most likely disease-causing variants. And then if you find a new gene or a new genetic defect in a gene that has not been linked to primary immunodeficiency, you really have to do a lot of experiments to show that what you find is really disturbing a certain process, and that's leading to the disease. What you can do, and that's an option that's done in several laboratories, that you use whole exome sequencing in combination with a PID filter. That means you perform whole exome sequencing, but you only look at the PID genes. So the other information is available, but you can decide not to look at that. So that can be done in the first step. And if you do not find a disease-causing variant, you can then decide, or together with the clinical geneticist, to open the exome and only then look at all the variants. So you can do the analysis in a two-step approach. And this approach is also gives more flexibility, because you can easily adapt your filter. So if there's a new gene, the information is there, you only add one gene in your analysis filter. And for the sample of the PID patients, they can be together a sequence with any other patients for genetic testing. So for example, with cardiac disease or any other or neurological disorder, in genetic laboratory they can do all whole exome sequencing in the same way, and depending on the disease you can use a different filter to analyze the data. For whole genome sequencing, the considerations are similar to whole exome sequence, but now you have many more variants because also the introns are sequenced. And that makes the analysis and the interpretation even more challenging. So the whole field of sequencing analysis and also the new genes to be identified, that will also be a topic of further investigation, not only for diagnostics, but also for research. I borrowed a slide for Kaan Botsoek. He also has a lot of experience in doing whole exome sequencing for identification of new monogenic diseases. And as illustrated here, the approach that's often taken for consanguineous families is that you do exome sequencing, but you also use the information of homozygosity mapping. So you look which regions in the exome are homozygous, and then specifically look at the variants in these regions. So that can facilitate you to find a monogenic defect. In case of a non-consanguineous family, often a trial analysis is performed. So you sequence both the father, the mother, and the patient. And all the variants are indicated here in circles. And you can find mutations. For example, if you consider it to be an autosomal recessive disease, that you can find a homozygous variant in the patient that is present in both parents heterozygous. So you can, in this way, you use the information of the parents to find the specific defect in the patient. It can also be that there are two heterozygous mutations in the patient in the same gene, and one appears to be from the father and one appears from the mother. So performing a trio analysis really helps you to identify the genetic defect in a more easy way. So all these strategies will also be discussed during the ESID meeting next year in Barcelona. There will be a session also on genetic testing organized by the Working Party Genetics, and also new genes that I identified will also be presented here. So I will come to the conclusions. The number of PIT candidate genes is really increasing, and I expect that it will still increase during the next years. And it's important to realize that one PID can be caused by mutations in different genes. And there's a lot of clinical heterogeneity. This in combination that there are different options for genetic testing, candidate gene approach, targeted enrichment sequencing, whole exome sequencing, whole genome sequencing, you can realize that the whole field of genetic testing is challenging, and you really need each other, because genetic testing is not a standalone assay. You really need to use the information that is available. So first of all, the clinical information, the immunological information, the bioinformatic support, the geneticist, and all together we need to work to identify genetic defect in the patients. I would like to thank you for your attention.